that in terms of the organizations, the professions, the professional satisfaction, the organizations that collect tariffs, the customs organizations, have had a much better time than the organizations that collect corporate profits taxes. And I'll try to explain why that is the case. But I want to start with a little story from my own country, the United Kingdom, and goes back to a conversation about 10 years ago. It is about 10 years since the British government merged its two separate revenue organizations that were previously called Customs and Excise and Inland Revenue, and merged them into one organization which is now called HMRC, Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs. And it was just after this merger that I was talking to a gentleman who had just retired from the Inland Revenue and had been in the Inland Revenue when it had been merged with Customs. And he presented me with an account of that merger that involves quite a lot of stereotype, and I think a stereotype which would be familiar to anybody. The stereotype he presented to me might be what you call the brains versus the boots stereotype. He explained to me that people in Inland Revenue were really quite accomplished, educated people. They'd often been to university. They were essentially dealing with statistics and accounts, and they had it all up here. And customs, of course, were not those kind of people at all. Customs were people with boots. But to me, they're the people who would break down doors. They're the sort of tough guys. And he presented this to me in the context of a lament that when these two organizations had been merged into one, that nearly all the leading positions in the merged organization had been taken not by people like him from Inland Revenue, the intellectuals, if you want, as he saw it, of tax collection, but by people from Her Majesty's Customs and Excise. So that is the stereotype. I didn't actually mention to him at the time that there is possibly another layer to the stereotype. It's not just boots versus brains. It's also, we might say, extroverts versus introverts. People like him, who are terribly good at doing numbers and sitting in front of computers, are not always natural leaders of organizations. And it may be that people from customs are rather more extrovert people who make better leaders of organizations. But regardless of whether that's true or not, that little conversation gave me a theme for my talk today. Because it occurred to me, thinking about this talk, that actually the story he presented to me of a relatively successful customs cadre and a relatively unhappy cadre of collectors of internal revenue, especially collectors of corporate profits tax, actually represents what has happened at the global level over the last 20 or 30 years. So what I want to do is talk a little bit about what's happened at this global level over the last 20 or 30 years. And I want to start by introducing you to a couple of characters. This is Eric. Now, when I drew up this talk, I didn't realize that I was actually going to follow a talk by Professor Eric Maskey. So I want to assure you, Eric, this is not my man, this is a completely different Eric. And I want to suggest to you that Eric actually has had a rather good time over the last 20 or 30 years professionally speaking. That his organizations have done rather well and are really quite widely recognized, and he's probably getting quite a lot of professional satisfaction from his job. And here are some of the reasons that Eric seems to have done quite well. You might say that he's faced a rather challenging work environment, but a work environment in which the challenges have on the whole been manageable. So there has been, as we all know, and Professor Muskin said, an enormous expansion of trade, including some quite challenging kinds of trade, different from before, including small consignments. There has been a very successful move of customs organization into what we broadly call trade facilitation and into security issues worldwide. And I think it's important to recognize that, because if you had 20, 30 years ago, when value-added tax started to become very widespread, and many countries in the world were greatly reducing their tariffs, your prediction for the future of customs as an organization might not have been a very optimistic one. You might have said that they're in a declining business. But in fact, customs has taken on other roles and has been, I think, a very successful business. And I think you see that also in the international organizations, which the World Trade Organization and the World Customs Organization are relatively successful organizations. In particular, they are both organizations that represent a very large fraction of countries in the world and actually are able to reach agreements that are then binding on their members. So they are, in that sense, fairly strong organizations with global governance. I realize that many people will question if I say that the World Trade Organization has been successful, because there are an awful lot of concerns about so-called Doha round, which hasn't worked terribly well. So it's not been an unambiguous success, but I think successful nevertheless. So, you know, Eric is really looking in his prime, energetic, strong, powerful, knows he has a great career in front of him. This is Erica. Erica is not really as happy as her. Erica collects corporate taxes, and the last 20, 30 years have not actually been that good to her. You can see Erica is rather depressed. Well, there are a number of reasons for this. Let me go through them very quickly. First, it has become clear that the corporations that Erica is responsible for taxing find it increasingly easy to avoid or evade taxes at the national level, that is, taxes on transnational economic activities. We know, Professor Maskin again talked through the economic globalization and the form that has taken. But one very important element of globalization has been the opportunities for corporations to avoid and evade taxes has increased considerably. So that is one problem for Erica. The second problem for Erica is that tax havens, places where money can be stowed almost in complete secrecy very often and with very low or zero rates of tax havens have expanded considerably since the 1960s and 1970s and now are a very important component of the world financial system. The third problem for Erica is that in many countries of the world, especially some of the richer OECD countries, I'm including in particular my own country, the UK, there has been in the last 10 years an enormous growth of public campaigning by social organizations of various kinds, exposing the extent of tax avoidance and evasion by transnational corporations, and therefore publicly revealing the extent to which Erica is really not able to do her job very successfully. And one of the results of that is that in 2012, 2013 in particular, the G8 group of countries and the G20 in particular became so exercised about this problem of evasion of taxes by transnational corporations that this became a major theme of the G20 meeting, and the OECD was then ordered to do something about this problem and to report back in 2 years. And the OECD has been very busy for the last 2 years, engaged in something called the BEPS process. BEPS is a shortened form for base erosion and... Interesting, I forgot. I'm so used to talking about BEPS that I've immediately forgotten. Anyway, so I will come back to me in a minute. But it is an acronym for the general process of tax avoidance and tax evasion. And the OECD will be publishing its final report on the BEPS process in October, which is now next month, and then the international community will be required to, or be expected to do something to implement those recommendations. And they will be complex recommendations. But I want to look a little bit more about why Eric is doing so well. As I mentioned earlier, he is doing very well. I think probably one of the most important events is that the World Trade Organization was formed in 1995, I can't remember exactly, but quite a long time ago, replaced the General Agreement on Trade and Tariffs, and is a relatively authoritative, representative organization that does impose rules on its members. And similarly, the World Customs Organization, as I said, is an authoritative organization that does impose behavior on its members and is able to do so. So, for example, and I'll come back to this later, when it comes to issues of what we call transfer pricing and mispricing, the World Customs Organization has a very clear set of rules for how to deal with transfer pricing and mispricing, which are binding on members. That is not true in the other area I'm talking about, but in the OECD arena. And I'll come back to that. So that is one positive factor. The other one, as I said earlier, is that customs organizations have actually been able to respond quite effectively to new agendas. One might have expected 20 years ago that the spread of value-added tax, as I said earlier, was going to be a great threat to customs. But in fact, it's proven to be the opposite. And that's particularly true in low-income countries, where often a very high proportion of all value-added tax that's actually collected is collected by customs organizations. And value-added tax, both on imports and then the rebates on exports, have given customs organizations an organizational intellectual challenge that on the whole they seem to have met, with some exceptions, and especially in the area of refunds of VAT. But similarly, the World Customs Organizations have responded to the challenge of trade facilitation, of security, and generally have a rather good reputation for dealing. But there's one other, rather more concrete, almost arithmetical point that I think is quite important. Why Eric has done so much better than Erica. And this is ultimately to do with the differences between trying to tax an organization on the basis of net income or trying to tax it on the basis of gross income or some other gross value. And the point, central point is here, that if you're trying to tax any organization on the basis of gross income or gross value, any underrepresentation of that gross income or gross value matters much less than if you're trying to tax an organization on the basis of net income. Because the second paragraph explains on that issue from the basis of net income. than does the undervaluation for the purposes of customs. And so Erica has increasingly become enmeshed in this problem that relatively small undervaluations at some point in international trade have very big impacts on assessed corporate profits. So what I want to do now is talk a little bit more about why Erica, who is trying to tax corporate profits, is doing rather less well. Well, the first point that I won't talk about, which is obviously becoming increasingly important, is that the growth of the digital economy and immaterial products crossing borders is a much bigger problem for taxing corporate profits than it is for customs most of the time. But that's a problem for the present and the future, and let me talk a little bit more about the past. Second point is that there is no single globally representative authoritative revenue organization for dealing with the taxation of corporate profits of transnational corporations. As I mentioned earlier, when the G20 and the G8 became very concerned about this issue of underpayment of taxes by transnationals, they referred the issue to the OECD as being the most authoritative and competent international organization to deal with this, which indeed it is. But the OECD does not represent the world. It is, as The Economist magazine always reminds us when it talks about the OECD, it is a club of rich nations. That club of rich nations certainly represents a very high proportion of the world economy, but it nevertheless does not represent the whole world, and does not represent low-income countries. Now, this issue has recently become much more contentious because the governments of low-income countries have observed that representative global organizations, like the G8 and G20, have handed responsibility for dealing with this problem to the OECD, which is really not representative. And increasing questions have been raised about whether this is fundamentally right and whether low-income countries can really expect their interests to be represented by an organization in which they are not represented. And in July, about 2 months ago, there was a big conference in Addis Ababa on the future of financing for development, where interestingly, for the first time in previous years, these conferences were all about aid and how much aid would the rich world give the poor world. This conference was dominantly not about aid, and it was dominantly, in fact, about revenue raising by low-income countries themselves, which was positive. But one of the contentious issues in that conference, and was very contentious, was the whole question of who globally is responsible for issues of taxing transnational corporations. Now, there does exist within the United Nations organization something called the UN Tax Committee. I can be fairly confident in saying probably none or very few of you in the room have ever heard of the UN Tax Committee, which is not surprising. The UN Tax Committee is a committee. It's a very small organization. It actually consists of two people for the world, and it has virtually no budget. So a meeting of this size is completely beyond the expectations of the UN Tax Committee. But at the Addis meeting, there was a proposal from some low-income country governments, and indeed from many tax activist organizations, that the UN Tax Committee should get additional resources. And indeed, the maximal suggestion was that it should become an intergovernmental organization. This was deeply resisted and indeed finally rejected. And we are still in a situation where the OECD represents the whole world. Now, I didn't distinction here. The OECD Secretariat includes many people who are deeply aware of this problem and have tried very hard in their discussions to involve the governments of developing countries as best they can. But there are limits to how far they can actually give authority to governments who are really not members. So the other reason, and the bigger reason why Erica is having a very hard time, is that I said earlier, the system for taxing corporate income from cross-border activities is very leaky, and it has become more leaky as a result of economic globalization. And the OECD governments have so far proven very reluctant to try to do anything about it. They changed their mind rather in few years ago, basically because after the global financial crisis and the large-scale bailout of financial institutions worldwide, most OECD governments found themselves facing fiscal deficits of varying sizes, but sometimes rather large, and they have shown much more interest in raising tax revenue. So a leaky, increasingly leaky global system that enabled large transnational corporations to avoid paying taxes became a problem for the OECD governments. So they started to pay much more attention to reforming the system. And I now want to talk about what the system is. And I think the first thing to say is that the system is, as I said earlier, is not one which is enshrined in any international agreement or treaty, and is not the responsibility of any single international organization. The system is actually rather a mixture of different elements. And I just want to talk about a few of those elements that seem particularly important to me. And the first one, which many people might bypass, is the fact that we live in a world where it is almost universally agreed that the right way to tax companies is to tax them on their profits. Now, that sounds like something that's so perfectly obvious that how could anyone possibly challenge that? And any economist would tell you that this is the efficient way to tax companies, and this is the norm, and why would you question it? Well, that would be fine if we were lived in a world where the authorities doing the taxing had something like equal bargaining power with the companies they're taxing, which is to say they had something like equality in terms of the quality of the personnel, the information at their disposal, their resources, and all those other things. In countries like my own, the situation is probably fairly close to that. The battle between companies and Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs is not a grossly unequal one. Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs can strike rather hard when they want. But in many low-income countries, this is a very unequal battle, because the revenue authorities claim to tax customs are short of staff, they are short of very trained staff, they do not have systems in place for getting information, they can very easily lose staff to the very companies they're trying to tax because they're worth more to the companies than they are to the revenue organizations, etc. So this is a very unequal battle. And in those kind of conditions, attempts by revenue organizations to tax companies that are engaged in very complex economic activities with major cross-border elements to them can result in companies being grossly undertaxed. And for example, telecoms is one of these areas where you have very large transnational telecom companies operating seamlessly across borders of, let's say, East Africa, for example. It is very hard actually to tax those telecom companies on the profits they make in Kenya or Uganda or Rwanda or any other country, because it's almost impossible to work out what those profits are. And in those circumstances, some governments do actually charge an excise tax on the use of telecoms as de facto recognizing that it's very hard to tax profits. A similar problem is found in the area of extractives, and especially in the area of mining, where very large and powerful international mining companies completely control enclave mines. They import virtually all inputs. They export and they market internationally all the exports, and they control the terms on which these things, the information is spread around those things. So mining is grossly undertaxed. It would probably make sense in such a case to tax mines much less on the assessed net profits of mining companies that can so easily be falsified, and use some kind of gross measure such as royalties, variable rate royalties. So that is one element of the current system. A second element of the current system is what's called the residence principle. And this is a very long and complicated story. Goes back to the 1920s. Presented to you in the simplest possible form. It was first in the 1920s that governments, mainly the richer governments, began to notice that they were home to companies that were for the first time significantly transnational, which is to say they had activities in other countries that were generating significant revenues. And there was a discussion initially under the League of Nations of how best to tax profits from these transnational activities. And at that point, it was essentially pointed out that there were two logical ways of setting up a system of taxing those profits. One is that you could regard any single company that had transnational activities as a single integrated enterprise that was using the resources of one country for one purpose, another country for another purpose, marketing elsewhere, and that it really didn't make sense to treat this company, this one large group, as a set of separate companies, but you should tax it globally, worldwide, as one unit. And you should tax it as one unit and then try to apportion the tax from that unit according to where value was created in the various countries in which it had activity. Now, I'm not going to talk any more about that because that is a system that hasn't so far happened. It's often called a unitary taxation system. It is possible that the world might move to such a system. I'm not going to predict that it does. It would be a very complex system, but possibly no more complex than the system we have. Because the system we have involved accepting another principle. And the principle was that transnational companies could decide whether or not their units in various countries of the world should be incorporated locally as local companies and therefore taxed locally in the countries where they were incorporated. And this was the system that was adopted. And it's so familiar that it seems surprising that one could think of anything else. Now, one of the key results of choosing that system was that, in practice, the location of profits, company profits for taxing purposes, became increasingly discretionary. That is to say, the transnational company at the global level could increasingly choose where in the world it was going to account for its profits. And you could do that simply because that transnational company, and they became larger and more sophisticated, was actually engaging in a very complex set of transactions with all its subsidiaries and affiliates worldwide. It's not only importing from them either raw materials or semi-finished materials or final products. It also has affiliates that are engaged in marketing, affiliates that are engaged in financing, affiliates that are engaged in owning intellectual property, affiliates that are engaged in providing management and advisory services, etc. And once you have a system of a very large number of transactions among among all the affiliates of a large transnational group, you have the scope for making choices about the value to which you attribute to those goods and services as they cross border. Because these are controlled transactions between affiliates and subsidiaries of the same big company. And so somewhere centrally, you could decide that you don't want to take profits in this country for one particular reason, you want to take them somewhere else. And it's a simple matter, relatively simple matter, of under or overvaluing the goods and services that you're transferring between affiliates. And that is the system that has grown, and it is that transfer mispricing, as it's known, that is to say, deliberately choosing prices which are not normal arm's length prices, but are decided for tax planning purposes. That system of transfer pricing is the core of the problems that Erica has today in taxing transnational companies. Now, there are other elements of the system that I'm going to mention very briefly and move on. One is that until recently, we have had no global system for the exchange of information amongst tax purposes among tax authorities. There has been a rather hodgepodge mixture of different systems of information exchange that have depended heavily on bilateral treaties of various kinds and bilateral arrangements between different governments. That is now changing. One of the most positive things the OECD has done is to set up a system for the automatic exchange of information for tax purposes among revenue authorities. It is still not a global system. It is still covers mainly OECD countries, but it's expected. A fourth element of the system is that there is a very big role for bilateral tax treaties. We have, I think, something like 4,000 bilateral tax treaties in the world between governments that are both very complex, but because of the way they're established, they often involve fairly standard clauses that actually remove from the governments of low-income countries some of their taxing rights. And the point here again is that many governments of low-income countries have negotiated bilateral tax treaties in the hope of getting investment, but without fully appreciating what they were giving away when they were negotiating those treaties. That is also a subject of current concern with the OECD. And the fifth point is, as I mentioned earlier, the growth of tax havens, which have now become a problem for the even for the richer OECD governments, who have made a major effort to do something about this. So, let me just review some of the major consequences of that system. There is a wide scope for transfer of this pricing of goods, finance, intellectual property, that's leading to a lot of tax evasion. That the tax authorities of low-income governments are relatively systematically disadvantaged because they do not have the personnel and other resources to really engage in equal terms with many of the large companies that they're taxing. This is a particular threat to the revenue of the governments of low-income countries. As I said earlier, they tend to depend relatively heavily on two sources. One is taxes on international trade, and the other is taxes on the profits of corporates. Now, this is an inefficient system, and no doubt they would be better off if they had a broader tax base. But low-income countries face a major problem that most of their economies are highly informalized, and it is simply not possible at present for them to levy the taxes on personal incomes and social security taxes that are levied by the governments of the rich OECD countries and which form the core of their revenues. So they are rather locked into a situation where they depend heavily on corporate taxes, probably inefficiently so, but are in danger of losing some of these revenues as if the rates of tax, taxation on corporate profits decline. Finally, it is not yet clear how far the OECD as an organization will persuade some of the, what I call the big boys, I mean governments like the governments of the United States, governments of Britain, etc., to go along with the reform proposals that are going to be put to them in October. I'm not going to make a prediction here. I am going to make a prediction, actually. There will be relatively comprehensive suggestions for trying to patch up the current system. It seems unlikely that the richer governments in the world, and especially the government of the United States, is going to be very strongly committed to those reforms. I can give a number, I won't take time now, I can give a number of reasons to believe why that should be the case. But the core reason is simply that the United States, for example, is sufficiently powerful globally that to some degree it can take unilateral actions over taxation that meet some of its immediate needs, and it does not necessarily need to go along with and agree with to change the global system, and particularly is reluctant to go along with changes to a global system to which it becomes committed and tied. And that in turn is because many of the potential losers of reform are very large transnational corporations which are headquartered in the United States or my own country, the United Kingdom, and a few other rich countries, and they are rather good at lobbying. So, where does this leave the World Customs Organization? Well, I'm not going to give you a particular message, or a very strong message, but my general message has actually been that comparing people like you in the room in customs, the Erics of the world, with the Ericas of the world, I see you as looking rather cheerful and happy. I think you have rather good jobs, jobs that give a lot of professional satisfaction. You could reasonably say, of course we have our problems, but we have contributed quite a lot to the world. And if I were talking to the Ericas of the world, I would say that I feel really sorry for you, because if you'd gone into customs, you would have had so much better professional life. You made the wrong decision on here. Is there anything that the Ericas of the world can do for the Ericas? Well, I'm not sure, this might be a little provocative. But as you know, an academic and something of an outsider to global taxation systems, I am continually surprised, impressed but surprised, about the extent to which different parts of government's revenue collecting systems do not cooperate with one another. This is not just an issue of levels of cooperation between customs and what we call internal tax. You often find the same thing even within internal tax. But I'm just going to end up with the observation that we have a world in which there is a great deal of goods and services cross borders, and where there are temptations for transfer mispricing. And in the case of physical goods in particular, we seem to be in a world where in the same country, there are often two organizations that are actually collecting information on these transactions and therefore have information on potential transfer mispricing. But the extent to which those organizations collaborate and cooperate with one another, some people would say leaves something